recording from, and this is what happened in a, this is a 2-month experiment. We see that, of course, there is some gliosis around, but this, the green, are neurons, so we can see many healthy neurons close to the electrode, and these are the cells we are getting the signal, the electrical signal from. Even we are using, for instance, in some related application, in this case, the same electrode we are using in vitro experiment, not in vivo, for getting recordings from retina. So we can see here some nice recordings. In this case, it's an on cell. This is the light. Where the light is on, we can see a nice cell firing, and this is an on-off cell in this case. So the system is able to work not only in vivo, but also in vitro experiments. So some of the main challenges we have right now is to improve our technology, to improve the three-dimensional distribution, to improve, because it's a problem, still it's a problem to insert many probes at the same time. The idea is to, because the problem is that the surface of the brain is not flat, it's some curve, so we are trying to adapt our technology to the convolute regions of the brain. There is also other problems related with what happened at the nanoscale interface, so we try to improve the electrode performance, and I would like, we were working before by using the term biocompatibility, but this is some samples, for instance, this is some piercings, and in theory, the piercing, the material, are highly biocompatible, but you can see that even if biocompatible, there is an infection and some clear damage. So always, we are going to put some device, an external device into the brain, we are going to get some reactions, some inflammatory reaction, but we try to keep this reaction, I will say normal, just no over-reaction, no inflammatory chronic reaction, and so on. And it's important, we are working now, we try to improve our basic knowledge
of
implantable electrode, gliosis, and tissue response inflammation. Just to finish, one of the applications of the future demonstration of NeuroPros is to use this technology to help people with visual problems, so to develop some prototype, some electrodes into the visual part of the brain and to induce, to send that part of the brain visual information. Diana told already about the retinal implants, but in some cases there is a damage of the whole retina, of the ganglion cell, the opus cell of the brain. So this approach is not useful, but we can try to send that information directly to the brain. So the idea we already developed in the context of another European project, CORTIVIS, one bio-inspired encoder, so we are able to transfer the visual information, and the idea is to use the NeuroPros to send this information strategically to the visual part of the brain, to the occipital cortex. But one important question arises. What happens with the visual part of the brain with someone become blind? Is doing nothing or is doing something else? And I would like to show you this slide. This is this was a woman that was working for the Spanish Blind Organization in Madrid. So she was reading Braille almost 5 to 6 hours a day because was working at that. And suddenly he has a problem. He has an infarct, goes to the hospital. Fortunately, she recovered. And the neurologist say, you have been very lucky because the infarct, the damage, affect mainly this white, is the visual part of the brain, the primary occipital cortex, and because you are blind. So she was very happy. She tried to get the agenda and tried to, the Braille agenda, and she discovered that she was not able to read Braille. She says, I never will learn Braille at all. So the idea is maybe this, or she, this lady was using this part of the brain for decoding visual information. So if we put some electrical information, maybe we can induce some other senses. We can induce auditory perception, tactile perception, and so on. Now, in one of the studies we are running in the lab is by using transcranial magnetic stimulation, that is a non-invasive methodology, and we are using this on the occipital cortex of many blind users, many blind volunteers, and we know, this is just, that in some blind volunteers, it's relatively easy mainly, I will say, short time, less than 10 years after the onset of the blindness, we are able to induce some visual perception, but after that, it's going more and more difficult. So the brain is changing. There is some plastic adaptation, and in order to develop any, clinical useful device, we should also take this into account. So there is a time windows for visual prosthesis, and this is very important. So the categories of the present limits are mainly the information coding strategies. We have to improve. We need a better understanding of brain plasticity. Of course, there is technological challenges. We have to develop some stable and reliable neural interfaces, and we have to improve all the electronics related with the device. We think that the only way to achieve these kind of goals is to take into account the physiology and the pathology of the nervous system, all the recent advances in technology, all these new discoveries in neuroscience, the social needs and all the implications, and also all the clinical and surgical expertise and the implementation, rehabilitation, ethics, and only taking into account all this knowledge, we will be able to develop some useful devices for the future. This is the line. I would like to thank the European Commission and, of course, the NeuroProf team. This is one of the meetings in Cambridge, so thank you.